Parents, the following program is intended for people over the age of 13. If your kids are younger than that, please use the YouTube Kids app.
Welcome to Scary Stories, the channel that tells you scary stories.
Peter Bernard's Scary Stories for Adults.
Welcome to Scary Stories NYC. I'm your old pal Bigfoot, and I'm very glad to be back. Taking 2 days off on YouTube can be like taking a week off of anything else. All our equipment seems to be back up in working order. Let's keep our fingers crossed. We've got the story you voted for today, which is Mother Bear versus Dog Man. But first, I'd like to thank today's executive producer, Devin Byam. Work was hell, but that's all swell. Then it turned to heaven, thanks to cool-ass Devin. I sure hope that's how you pronounce it, Devin, because we really appreciate your contributions to help keep our show moving forward. When our equipment failed, we were able to replace it and only lose a day getting back thanks to our executive producers like you. You know, all of you can become an executive producer of Scary Stories just by joining our club at peterbernard.com or by clicking the join link beneath this video. 9 hours of R-rated Dogman stories and growing at peterbernard.com. Okay, now on to our feature attraction. Let's face it, running into a mother bear who's protecting her cub is about the scariest and most deadly thing that can happen to a person. Except for maybe walking into the middle of a battle that the promoters are billing as Mother Bear versus Dog Man. Dear Scary Stories NYC, I've got the mother of all Dog Man stories here, and you can take that in a number of different ways. Please don't mistake that jovial introduction to mean that my story isn't scary, because this was the scariest thing that ever happened to me. I've been watching some of your back episodes, and I saw the one about that drive-in in Pennsylvania. I watched it with interest because that's not the only drive-in movie theater in the middle of a bunch of farms in PA. I grew up in a town named Gratz, and right nearby is the Skyview Drive-In. It has a lot in common with the one you described, and the folks who work there are very nice. I don't know if they're open right now, I would guess not, but I'm not in PA anyway, I left before the lockdown set in. I hope they can open soon, because they are loved by the community up there. I don't just mention the Skyview Drive-In randomly, as my story happened fairly close to there. You could say it happened within walking distance of the drive-in, as though anyone walked to a drive-in. See, the town I used to live in, Gratz, is just west of the Skyview and just north of a weird patch of woods. My friend we can call Marcus and I used to call it dramatic names like the Woods of Weirdness and the Forest of Mystery, because it felt to us that something weird happened to us almost every time we went there. I mean, we had campgrounds in the area, but Marcus and I would go for outdoor sleepovers in that weird patch of woods to the south. I don't think we were supposed to be there, but nobody ever kicked us out, so we kept going back. Plus, we liked the weird stuff. It never reached paranormal levels, so it's pointless to mention any of the events other than to explain myself. Like, one time we found a single sneaker. It was a blue Pro Keds sneaker, and I don't remember if it was left or right. It looked fairly new, but a little worn in, and it was a high top, laced, and tied all the way up to the top. We made up stories of how it got there like that. Maybe the guy's foot evaporated, leaving the sneaker behind, but his other foot was fine, so he went home. Stuff like that. Nothing to write a scary story about, but enough to entertain bored teenagers and keep us coming back to the weird woods. Anyway, the scary thing that happened to me didn't happen when Marcus was there at all. I had come back home from college. I was 22 years old, and Marcus had gotten married and moved away somewhere out west, I think. The marriage didn't last, but he never came back as far as I know. I wanted to hang with him, but it wasn't an option, and I ended up walking out of town toward the woods with my sleeping bag and my backpack. I was going to sleep in the Woods of Weirdness one last time, say goodbye to Marcus and my teenage years, then wake up the next morning, ready to be a man. Little did I know how real my rite of passage was about to become. I guess I should mention here that it was dumb of me to go out camping alone in the woods. I guess I thought of that forest as my backyard, since it was walkable from the house I grew up in, and I had spent so much time there. However, in Pennsylvania, bears will walk right through your backyard sometimes in the spring and summer. I'm not even kidding. You can go look it up, and I'll wait right here for you. Of course, they're not supposed to be walking around in the middle of the night with their cub or cubs, as far as I know, but I'm getting ahead of myself here. I picked a spot near where I thought we had camped before, did a little tribute to Marcus in the dark, then settled into my sleeping bag to sleep directly on the ground, staring up through the trees at the stars. It's an incredibly powerful and surreal feeling to be there in the woods, staring up into infinity, and although I think it's something everyone should try at least once, you should only try it in a safe way. Maybe if you and a group of friends decide to do it, that might be okay. You have to remember, you can get trodden on by deer, and a deer hoof is as hard as a baseball bat. You shouldn't try it unless you're a very advanced camper, and even then, have GPS and a personal locator on you in case of emergencies. I might also suggest a means of defense, but I don't know if you're allowed to talk about that on YouTube, so I'll have to leave that part up to all your imaginations out there. It was dark out when I woke up. I first startled to be looking up at trees and stars. Then I remembered where I was and realized why I had awakened. Climbing out of my bag so I could go relieve myself, the sound of the crickets was just incredibly loud. It felt like quadraphonic times 12. The sound surrounding me, the chirping coming from everywhere. It was both comforting and unnerving at the same time. I remember walking and stumbling in the dark far enough away from where I was sleeping that I hoped I wouldn't smell it when I was trying to go back to sleep. Then I proceeded to do my business. Obviously, this was quite a relief, and I noticed that the sound of what I was doing had superseded the sounds of the crickets. When I wound down, I noticed that the chirping didn't return as I had expected it to. I sighed aloud, feeling much better, but as I made that noise, I thought I heard someone say something off to my left. Stunned and surprised, I looked over there with wide open, fully dilated, and panicked eyes, but I didn't see anyone there. It was very dark in that direction, too. Had I imagined hearing it? I remembered I was in the Forest of Mystery. Chuckled internally, then zipped up my pants. As I zipped up, though, I heard that voice again to my left, through the woods. I couldn't understand what they had said, but in my sleepy mind, it sounded just exactly like my old friend Marcus. I didn't know whether to run toward him or run all the way home in my bare feet. I missed him, but at the same time, he wasn't supposed to be there. He was supposed to be across the country with his new wife. It couldn't have been him, and it would make no sense for me to go looking any closer for that reason. I walked in that direction anyway, calling out, "Hello?" I meant it to sound self-assured, but it sounded timid, small, and frightened. Probably just as well. I didn't even know who I was calling out to. I remember staring where I was stepping on the ground, trying not to step on anything sharp or anything dead, and suddenly I took a turn around a tree and I heard that voice again. Now, I could tell that it wasn't saying anything at all. It was roaring insanely, incoherently. I was standing about 3 feet away from the largest land predator I was up till then aware of existing in Pennsylvania. I had been hearing a bear roaring in the darkness, but only catching a bit of it each time. Taken out of context and from a distance, almost any animal can sound sort of human, at least in split-second segments. We do all express ourselves with lungs and vocal cords, so it's only natural to find some overlap here and there. But to be wondering if my old buddy was pulling a trick on me, and then suddenly being confronted with the musky odor of the huge hairy meat eater, and to see those long claws and massive jaws, either of which could snap me like a twig without extending much effort. I didn't know that bears were nocturnal. Wait, they aren't, are they? Did this one have rabies or some mind-destroying illness? Why was it there? And why was it roaring at me? These were the kinds of half-thoughts flanking around in my panicked and empty tin can of a brain. I didn't know what to do. Then the bear roared again, and I did something anyway. I dove sideways to my left, thinking I could push through a bush there and run away, but finding it impossible to pass through. I shrunk down instead, hiding underneath the shrubbery as though that were going to protect me. The ground recessed under me a bit, and I was able to be partially covered by the leaves and feel some imaginary sense of half-safety. It wasn't working, though. I was still mostly exposed. My heart was beating so fast as I ducked my head down and waited for something very terrible and very painful to happen. I heard the bear roar again. I felt its paws beat the ground like it was a bass drum, and my face was wet with tears. Why was it here? And why was it so angry? And then, to my right, came a deep, scary, barking sound so loud that I bounced off the ground in shock. Looking over there, I saw a dog every bit as big as that black bear. Beyond the dog, I saw a 3 or 4 foot bear cub standing up on its hind legs and looking cute like Winnie the Pooh. It was just completely out of place cuteness in the scene of utter horror. But that cute little real-life teddy bear was the center and the cause of this nightmare that I found myself in the middle of. I had walked in between a mother bear and her cub, and the only reason I was still alive was that I wasn't the first to have done it. That dog was. I had to take a number and wait online to be mauled, I suppose. I tried again to find a way backward through the bush I was using as cover, but found it just as impassable as before. I was whimpering like a wounded poodle, practically trying to will myself through the vegetation to safety, but no go. I wanted to get out of there before someone won that standoff I was witnessing and decided to come for me next. There was no way to exit the scene without first climbing out in the direction of this developing battle, and I was way too scared to move an inch toward either of those monsters. I want to say that both animals were colored and sized so similarly that it almost was like two black bears fighting in some ways, but the dog's ears stood up tall and pointy like a wolf's, and bears' ears just don't do that. Plus, the dog had a kind of mane of fur around its neck, giving it a lion-like regality. I had never seen a dog as big as a bear before, and I don't think I'd seen one with a mane like that either. Although the same size roughly, the dog's body was not barrel-shaped. It was like a very fit but very trim black dog. The front and back legs, the chest, rib cage, there was nothing about the animal that looked like anything but an immense black canine. I was watching a bear versus a dog, not a bear versus a bear. Now, I want it clear that up till this point, the only ones who had been on their hind legs were me and the little cub. Mama bear and the big black dog were both on all fours. I was in no way thinking I was seeing dog man versus a bear. I thought I was seeing maybe black shuck versus a bear, possibly, but most likely just a dog that grew extra large. The most remarkable scene I have ever witnessed. While I was sunk as small as I could make myself down on the ground, I stared up and saw that black bear rise up on its hind legs, apparently intending to scare the large canine off. What happened next changed my worldview and paradigm and anything else in my life. I was one person before it, and another person after. And this life-altering sequence went like this. I turned my horrified glance from the now bipedal bear, and to my right. There, I saw the lion-like dog's eyes glow like something out of a CGI fantasy film. It looked like he turned them on or something, like he pulled a light switch and click, instant glowing Batman eyes. I couldn't even breathe. I thought I was hallucinating, and that the hallucination was going to eat me alive. Then, that dog reared back like a horse does when it's panicked or angry, and I covered my head, thinking he was going to come down again hard. That never happened. When I didn't hear what I had expected to, I opened my eyes and saw that the big black dog had stood up on his hind legs too. Only when he did, he didn't seem to be focusing as much on balancing himself as the bear was. This dog with a mane and glowing eyes didn't seem to have as much of an issue with standing. Apparently sensing it now had an advantage, the bipedal dog charged forward savagely, displaying the largest and most primeval-looking set of teeth I ever laid eyes on. The two of them were about to engage in a physical battle way, way up there in the air. I decided that this would be my best moment to attempt to escape the scene. So I scuttled along the edge of the bush like the cockroach I felt like in that situation, and I climbed around that tree and ran back to my sleeping bag, stubbing a number of toes and falling in the dirt another time. I probably would have gotten back there faster and less painfully if I had walked slowly, but fight or flight had kicked in, and I was trying to fly through those woods. I stopped at my sleeping bag to put my boots on, and I found it extremely hard to get my fingers to work, pulling the laces tight and tying them. I heard Marcus calling to me from the woods again, and my hands shook even more drastically. I knew I was hearing the bear. I knew that fight was still going on. I knew I was on the turf not only of that mother bear, but also an apparent actual real-life Pennsylvania dogman. I ended up carrying my boots and bag and backpack and walking out of the woods in my bare feet. I could walk all right. I just couldn't think or make my fingers do what I wanted them to do. I remember hearing the crickets coming back the further I got from that scene. Never was that sound so beautiful to me as right then. When I got out of the woods, I remember sitting down on the sidewalk and finally getting my shoes back on and my bag and my backpack. Life was returning to normal, I thought. Then I corrected myself. My new life was beginning. I didn't put it all together that night, but I seemed to have sort of had a death and rebirth ritual kind of thing. I went in a boy and came out a man. A man cockroach? Running away from monsters? Well, maybe so, but it could have ended so many other ways. I might not have survived my rite of passage at all. The further I get away from Gratz, the more I think about it. I miss that place. Not enough to actually go there while this virus thing finishes playing out, but I still miss it a lot, even though I was a pitiful, nervous wreck after the incident on the night it happened. I've grown fond of retelling the story. Girls seem to love it, or at least they humor me and pretend to. If they seem like they're getting into it, I tend to leave out the parts about me crying and scuttling away like a little roach. I make it sound more like I was brave, you know, for entertainment purposes. Even though that night, and for a year or two after, I was really traumatized by what happened, or maybe by what could have happened. These days, it feels more like a badge of honor. After all, how many guys can tell a bar story this badass? Show me anyone else who had a front row seat to see Mother Bear versus Dogman.
And now, get ready for an all-new, completely uncensored, slightly bloody, and absolutely terrifying new Dogman story. Oh, wait. YouTube won't allow me to tell you stories like that on this channel. If you want to hear that, you're going to have to go to peterbernard.com and sign up for our paid subscribers club. You can choose any price you can afford for a one-month subscription, and then every weekend, we tell you A story YouTube would never allow us to tell you on this channel. See you this Sunday for an all new, very scary, completely uncensored Dogman story.
Come back for more scary stories.